Della Torre is the head professional at Milwaukee Country Club, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He has been a PGA of America member since 1952. In 1986, Della Torre was the first person to receive the new PGA Teacher of the Year Award. The son of Spain's first golf professional, Angel Della Torre, Manuel was born in an apartment above his father's shop at the Real Club de la Puerta de Hierro in Madrid. The family moved to the U.S. in 1936. Della Torre was the assistant director of the Caribbean Tour for 15 years and has conducted golf seminars throughout the Caribbean, Central and South America, sometimes in English and Spanish, other times only in Spanish. He has instructed at workshops, seminars, and schools for numerous organizations in addition to the PGA of America.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Mike. I'd like to thank Mike for the opportunity to speak to you all and also the foresight of the PGA to start the educational program, not just for this summit, but what they've been doing throughout the years with their teaching workshops and so forth. I think it's an outstanding endeavor, and I think that we're going the right way. I can remember when somebody in the years past would have started to talk about their ideas and somebody would have said it can't be done that way. And I can tell you it's true because I experienced that. Today they don't say that. You may not agree with me, but you still listen. And to me, when you listen, you think. And when you think, you're using your mind. And unfortunately, we don't use our mind as much as we should. So when we get you to think, we're doing our job. Can anybody hear me? Okay. I'd like to read you something to start out the program, which I think you will be very impressed with. This is my pledge. When I was going to school, I always thought that the Pledge of Allegiance was the greatest thing I had ever heard. I never heard it in Spain, but I heard it in this country, and I thought it was a marvelous thing to experience. And I think that when today they're worrying about the Pledge of Allegiance in the schools, I think it's a very bad thing. I pledge allegiance to the swing and to the freedom which it provides. One motion, indivisible, dedicated to the joy of all golfers, regardless of race, creed, color, and I added handicap. And I think that that is probably the greatest thing and the greatest definition and the greatest advocate of a person that likes to swing the club. We're talking about terminology here in the last few days, and I want to tell you a couple of stories. One of them, which is rather embarrassing to me, or was, and it may be embarrassing to me today, but I'm going to tell it to you because I think it's very important. First of all, when I talk about my background, I always tell people that I came over here during the Civil War. And people look and say, gee, you don't look that old. And you take it for granted that they know that you're talking about the Spanish Civil War. Well, when you speak of Civil War, what did you think about? The American Civil War. You're not thinking about the Spanish Civil War. So we have to explain, or I have to explain in that case, that it was not the American Civil War, it was the Spanish Civil War. Well, when I came over here in 1936, we settled for a couple of months in New York, and I went to the high school called Rosslyn. Some of you from New York may know where it is. And when they found out that I was from Spain, they decided that it would be a good thing for me to talk to the students and tell them the differences between the schools in the United States and the schools in Spain. And one of my comments was as follows. The school that I was going to was a coeducational school, but the girls were upstairs and the boys were downstairs. And they always let the girls out of school before they let the boys out of school. So I was trying to show them that we had no contact with the girls in the school, in spite of the fact that it was coeducational. And I made this statement. Because of this, anytime you talk to a girl, you get very hot. Your mind's in the right place. But everybody in the class started laughing. Well, I didn't know why. Today I know what that means in a way. But you see, in the English language, more so than in Spanish, one word can mean how many different things? A lot of different things. And when you don't explain what you mean, you're not doing the job to your student. Because before you can do anything with your student, he or she must understand what you're trying to say. And unless you carry that in your mind when you're presenting your subject, you're not doing the job. You can have the greatest concept in the world, whatever it may be, but if the person that you're trying to teach it to does not understand, you'll fail. And then you wonder, why can't he or she do it? And they will wonder, why can't I do it? And it's not a fair position to put those people in. So I've been very careful, especially since those two words arose in that particular situation, to explain carefully and tell people, please take me literally. I can remember when I tried to use the word deliberate. And in those days, I did not know the English language as well as I know it today. I wish I knew it still better. But to me, when you did something deliberately, boy, there was some force behind it and some purpose. So I get this gentleman to be more deliberate, thinking that I was telling him the same thing, and he's getting slower. And I said, no, I want you more deliberate. So he still gets slower. So we have to be very careful that we really use the words that impart to the student that which we are trying to get them to understand before you even try to get them to do anything. To understand. Without it, we go nowhere. So this is one of the things that my father always told me. My father learned English and French and taught English in English and in French without having to go to school. He was just sent to England and he was sent to France to teach golf without learning the language. And I'll tell you, you learn quickly when you don't know the language. My father took me to school in this country when I came. He said, goodbye, son. He took me to school and left me there. And I'll tell you, you learn quickly. And you better learn the right words because kids, you know, they don't compromise. They don't compromise. So it made me very aware of what I've just told you. Say what you mean and say the things that represent what you're trying to get your people to do. This is very much on the mental side. We'll talk about that a little bit later in the second half of my discussion. But let's just talk now about the swing. Now, if they can project this on the screen, I am doing some photography work at the present time, and I'm working in the dark. I put a light on the club head, and I'm trying to get people to come in and have these pictures taken. And it's amazing how similar, when you take the body out, the clubs do the same thing. Can you all see that? See, all the shapes of the swings are almost identical. Now, my swing's in there, and all these people that you see here have been taught to swing the club. Not to use the body, but to swing the club. And consequently, all the motions that these clubs are making are very similar. Now, you can tell, say, for instance, in this particular case, that this gentleman has much more flexibility. He's a 22-year-old young man, and he is much more flexible. So he has a little reaction there that I don't have. I'm not as flexible. But we use these pictures to show the relationship between the concept that I'm trying to teach them and sometimes what they do. Now, if you take a look at the bottom two pictures, if you can see them over there, you will find that the arcs are not the same as the arcs of the person that has been swinging the club properly. And those pictures tell us a lot. You'll see what it means a little bit later when I talk about the concept. So we have to imply to the students, first thing, that the picture that you have of the swing must be correct. The principles that you are using to produce the picture must be sound. They can't work today and not tomorrow. I mean, you're playing this golf game because you're trying to play it for the rest of your life. And I certainly am not one that would like to have a game that works today and not tomorrow. I want it to work all the time. And I don't want to make changes in my swing. all the time. I want my people to swing the club and learn to handle the golf club and say, by golly, when I take this club now, I don't have to worry about what I'm going to do tomorrow. I will do this for the rest of my life. In 1942, after we're playing golf in Northwestern, I was very fortunate in going to the finals in the intercollegiates. And when I returned from there, my father said to me, how did you play? And boy, I was a little bit upset because I figured, my golly, doesn't my father realize I was number two in a national tournament? Why would he ask me how I played? So I kind of gave him a little sarcastic, well, I played very well. And then he said, do you know what you are doing? Not how I am doing it, what you are doing. I said, yes, I do. And then he said, does it work? And I said, well, if I do it, it works. And he had me right where he wanted me, like he always did. He always had a way of getting to me that way. He said, son, if you know what you're doing and it works, he said, spend the rest of your life perfecting it. And that's what I would like to do. And I'd like to see you all develop a concept, keep the concept, impart it to your students, and have them continue to perfect it. What is the most troublesome thing that you find when you teach a man? You teach him today, and you give him a concept, you send him to the golf course, he misses one shot, and what does he do? He changes. When you change, you can't produce a thing. Now, I'm not talking about improvement. I'm talking about changes that really change the basic motion which a person has. Now, if you have to change the basic motion, it means you didn't build it with sound principles. And when you don't build it with sound principles, you better change it and revert it to sound principles so it will work and you won't have to change it. And I say so many times, when you put this implement in a person's hand, they lose their common sense. And it's true. And if you analyze some of the statements that have been made to you as a teacher by your students, some of the things they tell you don't make any sense. Some of the things that we talk about don't make any sense either. What about this, if you want to hit the ball, swing down? Well, I say to my friend, my student, very good. Let's take another example. You're going to put a picture in the wall of your bedroom. So you're going to hold a nail against the wall. Now I want you to hammer it up and down. And he said, well, I can't get the nail in the wall. I said, that's right, you can't. Well, you can't send a ball that way if you swing the club down. Why? Because in physics, you will find that if you're trying to propel an object with another object in a certain direction, the direction of both objects must be the same. Now, I dare anybody to challenge that. If the ball is not going straight, it's going to the right, the club is not going to target. Therefore, the club is not going in the direction in which you would like to have it go. You can't deny that. And when people gave me a little hard time, I said, you play tennis? Sure. So, well, in which direction do you swing your racket when you're trying to hit the ball to the left corner of the left court? He said, well, I swing it over to the left court. And I said, that's correct. Why can't you think the same way about golf? So there are a lot of things that we use in golf which have no common sense. If I want to take this club and move it, I'm going to move it. I happen to be the advisory professional at one of the public golf courses for the ladies, and I go over there once a year, And I play a Beat the Pro Day, and I play one hole with each group. That's the shortest round I ever play. I start at 8:30 in the morning, and I don't get through till 4:30 in the afternoon. But it's fun. And I appreciate what these ladies are going through, and it's wonderful to work with them and see them try. One lady ran up to me from another hole, and she said, "Manuel, I want you to show me how to use my hips so I can get more power in my shot." And I said, "Well, what in the world makes you think that that's going to do it for your club?" She said, "Well, my husband keeps telling me," and I think her husband told her a different way, I think. Right. Ah, you're sharp. And I held her club out here, and I said to her, "Okay, now I want you to do this to your husband. When he tells you to get your hips into the shot, you tell your husband to do this. You keep your club and put it here and have him move his hips as fast as he can to the right." And she did this. And she looked at the club and she said, "It didn't go anywhere." She still stared at it and she said, "I can't believe that when I did this hard, it didn't go anywhere." I said, "Won't." I said, "Do it with your legs. Doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't go anywhere. Why? Because, unfortunately, my club is not connected to my hips, is it? It's not connected to my legs. Now, if I were doing it from here, I could move it with my leg, but I can't move it." I read the Hogan book one time, and he had a little red line around his hips, and he had another one connected to the part of the hand. And he said, "If you turn your hips, the clubs come down." So I'm staying there, and I'm saying, I'm wondering why this club doesn't come down. You see, you can only influence the club with that which is connected to it. Now, you take a person who has one leg. And we have one in Wisconsin by the name of Gary Qualley at Racine. He's a 5 handicapper, hits the ball much further than I ever thought of hitting it. Now you tell him to get his right side or move his club with his legs. He can. He's doing it with his arms and his hands and so forth and so on. Blind people can play. Now can you imagine a blind person doing something like this and trying to get the club to the ball? So where does this take us? Well, I want a motion that is efficient, is infallible, and repetitive. You may say, "Well, gee, that's almost impossible to achieve." It is not. But why do we have so many problems, both yourselves and myself and our students? Because we don't abide by three little words. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Once we start the club en route to the ball, we must leave it alone. Which goes along with what you've heard before, trust it. Why do you work so hard, practice so hard, if when you're going to strike the ball, you do all kinds of things and now you don't use the motion you've been working with? Trust it. That's what you work for. Leave it alone. And those are the three toughest words to abide by in the golf game today. We always feel that we have a brain. And this little thing, my boy, you don't have a brain. So I can do better than you can. And once this club is in motion, it can do much better than I can. So how do I achieve that? By swinging the club. Mr. Richstock, are you in the room? Would you come up, please? Mr. Tuck is going to give me a hand in my demonstrations and in my explanations. Notice that Mr. Tuck is referred to as Mr. Tuck. When my assistants get their own jobs, I have to call them Mr. And also one thing that I've always enjoyed about my staff, Rich just finished his term as PGA section president at Wisconsin, did a great job. And one of the things that I always pride myself in is that my assistants always remain good friends. And I've been very proud of Rich and what job, the jobs that he has done everywhere he's been. And I'd like to have him just give me a little hand in some of the things that I'm going to do. Once I get him up on stage, I can call him Rich again. Thank you for coming up, Rich. Now, naturally, in order to move the golf club, we have to hold it. And one of the things that I ask my students is this question. If you have an inanimate object, and you're going to control that inanimate object, what must there be between that inanimate object and yourself? Can anybody give me an answer? Contact. Without contact, you cannot move an inanimate object nor control it, therefore. So the first thing we have to do naturally is to hold it. We have to have the contact. Now, once I get them to hold the club, which I'll explain in a minute, I say to them, tell me, are you in contact with the club or are you in contact with the ball? And they immediately say, I'm in contact with the club. And I say, if you're in contact with the club and not with the ball, you can't do anything with the ball. So your concern has to be to hold the club and do something with it. The club will take care of the ball. And if you do the right thing with the club, can the ball do anything wrong? The answer is no, because the swing is infallible. Let's just move this back. It's nice to work with something that's infallible if we're willing to trust it. Now, in trying to put our hands on the club, we talk a lot about knuckles and we talk a lot about V's and things like that. And everything is fine and it's merely a guide. But where lies the truth? In my mind, the truth lies in the fact that when I'm swinging this golf club, I do not want the hands, the grip, to turn, to alter the club head as I'm coming into impact. Because if, as I'm swinging the club, through the centrifugal force that's being produced, the club pulls me, and that balances out my hands. Now, in order to keep that balancing out away from that centrifugal force, I have to use a lot of energy and a lot of effort and a lot of strain to keep it from happening. And that takes away my freedom, which in that card you said I'm pledging allegiance to. All right? So, I'm not going to go into the position of the hands because you heard it. I agree with what they've said, so let's just skip that and then just go ahead and proceed from there. Now, in order to test the grip, and I think that you all should do this, it's very important that you have the person grip the club as they would grip it. Now, I want you to grip it like, say, a beginner would with the right hand underneath. Now, when I test the grip, I have the person hold it this way. I put it in my hand with a little finger underneath to prevent slippage. Now, I ask Rich to keep his arms very supple, okay, really limp, and lean backwards. You see, the club has turned over. Now, this is very obvious. Now, when this happens, that means that the centrifugal force is balancing out the hands. And if you look at the hands now, the V's are at the same angle in relation to the shaft. But do we want this to happen when you're swinging? That's okay if you want to hook it. But my premise is that I want my ball to fly as a rifle. I want it going straight for the hole. I don't want it hooking or slicing, unless I want it to do so. If I'm in trouble in special shots, yes, I may want to hook it or slice it. But then I should be able to produce it myself. And myself means that I grip the club, not by changing my grip, but by changing my club position, and I let my swing take care of the whole thing. And when the club meets the ball in a different place, then it'll hook it or slice it. But my swing is the same. Okay, our eye sometimes is not as good as we would like it to be. And we don't have the knowledge of the construction of these hands so clearly for everybody. I mean, after all, everybody's hands are not the same. If they were, you could set up a stereotype position and say, okay, Now, you put the hand this way and it's going to work for everybody, but it doesn't. And the position that I want a person to have is the position that they need in order to keep the club from twirling in their hands as they're swinging. Does that make sense? I don't want my club just because I think that I should have my V's pointing to my right shoulder, then my club comes in this way because it's a centrifugal force, and then find that I'm hooking the ball all the time. So I want the hands to be placed on the club in such a way that when I pull that club from that person, the club stays square. And that's what tells me where those hands should be for that particular individual. Not what I like to have, not what I think they should be, not what I read in the books, not what experience I have. When I put that club, just grip it with your left hand. See, when he has that hand like that, and that club pulls, and that club turns in, I know that for him, that grip is not correct. Because I'm trying to get him to hit the ball straight. So what I do is I take that hand, grip it over, and I pull, it turns over, and now you see the hand is in perfect position for him. See, I can pull all I want, and it's not changing. So I hold it, I tell him to loosen it a little bit, and I take the club and straighten it, okay? And now I test it again. And if it doesn't move, that's the grip that he should have. Does this make sense? Do you all understand this? I do the same thing with the right hand. Exactly the same. If he has the left hand correct, which I've already tested, just put your right hand, left hand on correctly. Okay, now that's going to open a little bit, see? Okay, so I do the same thing. I just come over here, and I just turn it open a little bit. Okay, now I pull it again, and doggone it, as much as I pull, that thing isn't changing. So when he swings, that club is not going to close or open because of his grip. Now, he can close it or open it because of his action of not leaving it alone, but the grip is not going to change. So now we put the right hand on there. Now, if when that right hand on there, and I pull it again, and it closes, now I know the right hand's got to change. So we take this hand back to normal. All right, put the right hand on. And I move it up a little bit. Now I pull again. And as long as I pull, it's not going to change. Now, as far as I'm concerned, that's his grip. And you see, a form grip, as good as it is for real beginners, can't do this. It doesn't take into consideration the idiosyncrasies of the hand, so consequently, you're giving the same grip to everybody. And your grip, the grip that you should have, depends on how your hand is built. Now, some hands hang this way, some hands hang that way. Now, if your hand hangs towards the back a little bit, when you put it on the club and you make a person put it this way, what's going to happen? It's going to go back to its normal through centrifugal force, and you're going to have the blade open. So it's very important to test the grip. All right. How about now we have the grip, we have to align the club. So we take the alignment, and one thing that I have found in the last, say, 3 or 4 years is this. When a person takes the line, a lot of people come to me and say, I can't get my line. I'm always offline. And I find that people take the line, they go all through all this problem, going right behind the line, and then you see, when the moment they start to walk, they look at the ball. And the moment they look at the ball, they've lost the line. Now, if you were firing a rifle, would you ever take your eye off the bullseye? I don't think you would. If you were going to throw a ball at me, would you ever take your eye off of me? I don't think so. And if you were looking in a certain direction, and then you had to throw the ball at me, what's the first thing you would do? Turn around to find out where I am. And yet a golfer who wants the ball to go to the hole so badly will look at the hole, and then look at the ball, and get himself at the ball, and now look to see where he's going. It's completely off. However, even beginners, when you say to this person, when you look at the target, from behind. As you walk into the ball to place your club behind the ball, you must keep your eye on your target. Golf is a game of targets. Every time you propel this ball someplace, you're propelling it to something. It's a game of targets. How can you not keep it in mind? So, you look at the target and you keep looking at it. Now you walk close enough to the ball, you can see it out of your peripheral vision. And as you turn and take a step with your right foot, you're still looking at the target. And then you put it down. Then you can check it. You cannot believe the accuracy of that procedure when a person is trying to take their line. To support that, you must be sure that once they have looked at the target and put the club on the ground, that now their eye shifts from the ball to the club head. And they must watch that club head so that when they're moving their club themselves, they don't move the golf club. And the lines improve dramatically. Dramatically. I think if you watch good players, they do that. I don't think that when they take their eye off the target, just they're going to put the club on the ball, they don't know where to put it. But the average player is so concerned with the ball that it hypnotizes them even at that point in their game. They're already hypnotized before they ever take the club away from the ball. And when you get hypnotized by the ball, you have problems. Whether it's you or I or the average player. So that's the alignment that I proceed with. Now, where do I place the club? And here's where I'm sure a lot of you will disagree. Just like George Newson, I think balance is probably the most important thing that you can work with. What is the most important thing that any player would like to have in his golf game? Consistency. Consistency. You don't want to have something that's one way one time, a different way another time. You want to be consistent. Now, when I changed, and I'm speaking now of normal straight shots, I'm not talking about manipulating the ball, which in which case, naturally, I will put the ball in different places. But we're just talking about a normal straight shot, straight drive down the middle, down to the green, and so forth. I would like to place the club in the center of my stance. I want the angle of my feet in relation to the target line as close as possible. Now, we're human, so they can't be always exactly the same. But I want them similar. Why? You know the tendency that people have of swinging in this direction. When I take a person and they have this foot out and this foot straight, it's opening them a lot. Now, I'm not talking about the tour players. And please understand that in my discussion, the tour player is out of my picture. The tour player can do anything. They're athletes. They play golf every day. It's wonderful to know what they do. And perhaps it may be helpful when you teach them. But those are not the people that you and I are teaching. We're teaching people that are this big, that never practice, and we've got to give them something simple to do which is infallible. Now, as you see here, the swing is a lot more circular than we thought. This shocked me because I thought the swing was more elliptical. And bear in mind, please, that when I take these pictures, and I'm going to try to change that, I take the pictures from ground level. So when you take it at the same level and you're taking it this way and the swing is inclined, what happens to the distortion? It widens it this way and it shortens it in the up and the vertical side. So if I could take these pictures at right angles to the plane, what would happen? It would be even more circular. Yes, sir. Yes, indeed. It would be even more circular. So I have to have a center. If I'm going to describe a circle, I have to have a center. So I like to place that club at my center. Now, it was mentioned before in one of the discussions that before you can ever strike the ball with squareness, the center must be reestablished. Well, if it must be reestablished, why should I destroy it first? It's an extra move. So I want my students to stay here and keep the center in the same location, which means equal weight distribution from right to left as you swing to the top. That also makes the muscles in your body coil tighter. There's a much greater coil here than here. So if my muscles are going to help my arm swing the club, they're much more ready to respond if they're coiled than if they're not. So when I take the club back from the center, I find that whether I'm playing a little chip shot, whether I'm hitting my driver, whether I'm hitting my five iron, the direction of the departure from the ball is exactly the same every time. Now, if I move that ball around and I don't make other adjustments, the direction of departure is not the same. If I put the club to my left side, unless I make an adjustment, the club will have a tendency to go where? On the outside. If I put my club to my right side and I don't make an adjustment, the club will go on the inside. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's much harder to perfect 14 swings than one. And I don't want 14 or 13 or 11, however number of clubs I have in my bag. I just want one. I got enough worries with one. So if I play a little chip shot, I may get myself a little bit open, if that's the way I want to play it, but my center's still in the center. Now, the center is wherever the plumb line drops from your center here. Wherever it imparts the contact to the ground, that's where the place is. It's not dividing the distance between your toes in half. Because of the way that we're built, that is not necessarily true. You take a person, for instance, that has a tendency to put the left foot up a little bit, even though I don't like it, but if they're built that way, I leave them alone. Okay, I'm just telling you principles. And he splits the distance, then he's going to be out of balance, isn't he? Now, the tour players, you see, they can put the club over here, and they can get like this, and they can do fine. But you take a fellow that is about 50 years old, who wears a 44-inch slack, and you get him out there and see if you can make him do that. So you see, we can't treat the average player that you and I teach the same way as you have to treat the tour players. And some of the things that tour players do would kill the average player, no matter how interesting it is to know about it. And I certainly do want to know about it. And I certainly don't want to know what they're thinking and what they're trying to do. But can I use it for the average player? Are they as supple? Do they have the feel, the awareness that the tour player has? The answer is no, they don't. Otherwise, they would be out there playing with them. They just don't. All right, so now we've got the alignment, we've got the grip. Now, one thing that we want to be talking about a little bit is pressure in the hands. And I'm asked that question a lot. Now, pressure is a strictly individual thing. And the best answer that I can give you if you ask me, or anybody that asks me, is this. You grip the club with sufficient pressure to control the length of the club which you're going to use and the velocity with which you're going to use it. That's as much as I can do. When I say to a person, grip it tighter, am I telling him anything? How much tighter? 1%? 2%? How do I know how tightly they're holding it? How can I change the pressure that he has and say to him, when you hold it that much tighter, I can hold it with the same pressure you do? That's impossible. So when you're talking about pressure, the only word which I like to use is keep it constant, whatever it is. Don't allow it to change. However, as you are swinging, this centrifugal force does produce a very interesting change in your hand and finger pressure. But it's 100% instinctive, and it's dependent upon the speed with which you're swinging the club. You cannot say, well, you grip tighter with these fingers because now you're swinging at 10 miles an hour, and then you increase it tighter than that because you're swinging 100 miles an hour. It's strictly instinctive. Rich, just with your left hand, please. If I'm having him grip the club with constant pressure, and I pull just like this, his pressure will increase where? In the back of his left hand. Why? Because the club head always pulls the greatest from that point which is furthest from it. That's normal. All right? Now, if I pull harder, now I'm saying I'm swinging about 80 miles an hour, the pressure in his left hand, back of his left hand, is even greater. But now, if he goes to zero like this, now his pressure is constant again. Now it's even from back to front. So he has not changed his pressure, even though the pressure has ridden up and down the hands depending upon the velocity with which you're swinging the club. And that you can't prevent. And you shouldn't try to interpret. How tight should I hold it when I start the club? And this idea of gripping tighter with the last three fingers has come from this. Because naturally, when you swing the club back and you swing it forward, the last three fingers are definitely gripping tighter at that point because the pressure has gone from this point in the hand back to the back of the hand. So therefore, they are gripping firmer. But can you tell me how much firmer? People say to me, in terms of these common sense things I'm telling you about, well, I have to swing the club slower. How much slower? Well, I don't know. Well, then how can you swing it slower? How much slower? See, you can't just say things just for the sake of saying them. You have to have proof. You have to be precise. And when you are, you can do something. But you can't do it just by saying, well, my grip is tighter, so let him get it tighter. Doesn't work that way. All right. Remember that what I said. The pressure of the grip is an individual, instinctive thing. And all you need is sufficient pressure to control the club's length and the velocity with which you're swinging it. If you grip the club here, you will not need as much force in the grip as if you grip it here. And that has nothing to do with Delatorre's ideas. It's just a fact that if you do that, you will have to do that yourself. All right, so we've got ready to go. Now, what do we do with the club when we've got everything ready, trying to send the ball on its way? Well, we swing the club. And this is where people get a little upset with me, because they will not accept the fact that that is really all we need to do. Now, you will say, well, gee, how does a person get to swing it? That's my responsibility. I have to give you the feeling of the swing, and I have to get you to understand it and then produce it. Rich, come over here. Now, I and my teaching get very involved with my students. I do it, and they do it, and I'm there. So when I'm trying to give a person the feeling of the swing, I swing it for them. Okay? And I say, all right, now that's the swinging motion that we want to produce. Now you see, he's a little nervous, so he has not released his right foot. And that's the only part of the body that I work with. Now when I'm doing this, his right foot should be responding. Now watch it, don't let it respond this time. Now see, when it doesn't respond, then he gets a collapse in here. Now if he's responding, there's no collapse. Now this is because we're swinging the whole club, not just that little thing there that hits the golf ball. We're swinging the whole club from one side to the other. And when that happens, then you don't get the breakdown in the left wrist that we hear so much about. So we're swinging the club. Now, that's the swinging motion. Now, in order to start the club from the ball, the club head is my leader. It controls what I do. So what I like to do is to swing the club head with my hands around me to the top of my backswing. One motion, and my destination is over my shoulder. I don't want two motions. I don't want to worry about my plane. Now, I'd like to have anybody do this and not turn. Now, I can do it this way and let him go. If I'm swinging it, he'll be in the right place. His body will be correct, his balance will be correct, everything will be correct. Now, why do I have to worry about so many little things when if I swing the club this way, it puts me in the right perspective, the right feel, the right everything. So that's all I try to get people to do. What is the thing? But I have to give them the feel. So now once I've given them the feel, I have them close their eyes. And I say, now you swing it. Okay, now you swing it with your eyes closed. Now see, he didn't swing it. He used leverage going back. Why? Well, he did it this way. That's not a swing. In a swing, everything moves in the same direction, at the same time, at the same rate. That's why we can create velocity. That's why levers can't create velocity. Because in the leverage action, you got opposite forces working. They're great to develop a lot of power and lift heavy weights, but you can't create velocity with a lever. You have to have everything move in the same direction. So you see, I felt this, you see? All right, so now I tell him, no, you've got to swing it this way. Does it look different to you than this? That's leverage. All right, so he has to swing it. Okay, now you go ahead and do it. Now that's correct. All right, now swing it all the way to the top. That's correct. Now I know he started correctly, and if he swung it, he's going to be correct at the top. I know it is. All right. Now my arm can't go that far, so I can't swing it forward. So we're going to take a small swing here, and then I'm going to swing into the finish. Let the right foot go. All right, then let's swing. Switch transferred, hasn't it? The transfer of the weight is the result of the velocity with which you're swinging and the response which you have. Now, in my mind, what does the body do? Well, it's just like dancing. It was brought up before in one of the discussions. If a girl were dancing with me, what would she do? She would respond to what she sees me do or feels me do. Now, if she wants to go one way and I want to go another, we're going to have a little difficulty dancing. Now, if there's a sequence of motions, sequence. It means that something happens one time and something happens at another time. Suppose that we were dancing with a sequence and I want to go towards her and I move first and she moves later. I may like what I feel, but I'm not going to be able to dance very well. So the response has to be immediate. So in the backswing, the club head sets me in motion. The club head is set by the hands. But now what happens at the top of the backswing? A very interesting happens, and that is that the complete responsibility for the forward swing transfers to the arms, and they swing the whole club now from the top to the finish in one motion without interruption in the direction of that target. And that's all I have to think about. I don't have to think about anything else. And I was told one time many years ago, it can't be done that way. Well, I won my share of tournaments. My father won the Spanish championship 6 times. That's pretty good for a man who can't do it that way. But these people that come to you can't deal with the complicated things that we know happen in a golf swing. We have to be able to give them a motion that produces those things without their worrying about it. And when you have your student leave your lesson, they should say to you, that was easy. I like that. Instead of saying, gee, I don't know whether I can do that or not. I want the smiling when they leave there and feel that they can do it. All right. So much for the concept. But now, we know all of this. Now, what can we do for this student to make him do it? Which is really the thing that bugs us all. You see a person take a lesson and they do it beautifully, you see them on the first hole, and you wonder, where was I when he was here? Doesn't look anything like what you told him. Why? Number one, their purpose changes. When they're taking a lesson from the professional, they're Mr. Jones, number one. When they're practicing on their own, they're Mr. Jones, number two. When they're going out to play on the golf course, they're Mr. Jones, number three. And now we say to Mr. Jones, number three, I've arranged a game with your professional. He's Mr. Jones, number four. And the professional says, well, you know, I entered you in a little tournament today. He's number five. Now, how in the world can anyone be good being five different people within the same hour? Can't do that. You have to make these people become realistic. Why do they come to you to learn what you're teaching them? And when you ask them, they say, well, I want to play better. I say, well, why don't you do it on the course? But the purpose changes. When these five people can be changed into one, which one should they be? What's your guess? Number one. Why number one? Because when you are trying to make a swing with a professional, you're trying to work on your motion. And there are two ways of playing golf. You've got the subjective way and the objective way. Now, I had Carol Mann playing subjectively for all the years that she was good on the tour. She was playing subjective golf, and that means this is what I was taught, this is what I did it, and there goes the ball. And she never got into swing problems. Because when you're subjective, you're aware of what you're doing, and when you're aware of doing what you're supposed to do, you don't do anything wrong. And like Ernest Jones said to my father so many, many times, there's nothing wrong if you do it right. So we've got to get these people to realize that if this shot that they want is produced by the swing that they learned on the practice tee, that's what they've got to do. And I've got my girls on the tour right now trying to play without caring where the ball goes. Why? Well, because if they make the motion, and I'm not talking about getting mechanically, you know, detailed, things like that. Just like I told you, I've got my club here, I swing it to here, whoosh, right to target. And the ball goes there. It's an easy way to play competitively, too. It takes away all the pressure because you're doing something, you're involved with something that you understand, that you can do, you've seen the results of it. What's the doubt? So you have to be realistic. If I make this swing, the ball will go straight. You don't say to yourself like our members do, or people that may not be members but come to you for a lesson, well, I don't want to go to the right. Or I don't want to go in the water. And when somebody comes to me like that, I said, by the way, when you get up in the morning, do you think of all the things you don't want to do during the day? Well, no, I never do that. What do you do? Well, I make a list of the things that I want to do. Well, why do we change it for golf? Just because it's spelled G-O-L-F, life doesn't change. It's still the same. If you have a positive attitude when you're up in the morning that you're going to go to the hairdressers, or you're going to go to take a lesson, or you're going to go to see your son play basketball, you don't say to yourself, well, what am I going to do? Well, I'm not going to watch my son play football. I'm not going to watch my son play whatever. You make up your mind as to what you're going to do. Now, why in the world do golfers, and we're just as guilty as the average player, go out there and plan on not doing something? Strange. But we lose our common sense. We lose our common sense. And until we regain it, we don't succeed in what we're trying to do. I can remember one gentleman who said to me, well, I can do it with you, but I can't do it by myself. Well, that's ridiculous. I don't handle the club for the man. So we went out on a plane lesson. Every shot, I shot at him what I wanted to do. I would not let him take that club away without hearing what I wanted him to do over and over and over and over again. Maybe I repeated it two or three times before he ever got the club going. So he had no chance to worry about the bunker because, boy, that brain was hearing only one thing. Shot the best score he ever shot. I didn't handle the club for him, but I would not let him get away from the concept that the swing was supposed to be made with, and it worked. And it'll always work. But we've got to do it. A very interesting comment was made yesterday, which I appreciated having been here to hear it. The club can't do the work. You do it. And if you graft every single lesson you've ever had, it has a curve and then this way, curve. You always have the valleys. Why do you have the valleys? Because a person is very bad here, he comes up very fast, progresses very rapidly, and then he hits two or three shots that are very good, and he says, oh, I got it. And if you want to jump in the fire, just say, I got it. Because you'll get burned, but good. And I call this mental direction deterioration. In other words, once you hit a few good shots, you refuse to make your mind work to produce the motion that hit those three good shots. And as a rule, they'll last about 7 or 8 shots. That's about as much as they last. So you've got to keep working on their mind. You've got to keep working on their mind. Target orientation. How many of you, when you're seeing the target, get up to the ball and you look at the target while you're swinging, how many of you see the flag or the target, whatever it may be? You ever test yourselves? I'll guarantee the 90% of you do not see the target while you're swinging. And I would like to say that the average player never sees the target while they're swinging. Well, if you don't know while you're swinging where that flag is or your target is, can anybody tell me how you're going to swing the club at it? No way. I was asked this morning by my good friend Mr. Williams over here, or Rick, there somewhere. How do I train myself? Very easy. When you close your eyes, you still see the person you're talking to. Now, if that image disappears before you've met the ball or before you started to swing the club, you're gone. You're gone. While you're swinging, you must consistently see the flag so you have some place to swing the club to. If you're making a swing and the club is going to the target, can anybody tell me where the ball's going to go? Will it go any place but the target? Can't. And the body, through all of this, is just responsive to the elements of the swinging motion that's produced with the golf club, because that's the tool that we're going to use to propel the club to the target, and your body doesn't. Your body never comes in contact with the ball. And your body, and I'm speaking now not of the expert tour players, in general, anytime the body does something, it changes the character of the club head. Because you and I do not know how our body works. And we have to depend on something to move it for us the right way. Every time you change the swing, the golf club's length, you are changing your body motion. And when a person tries to swing the club with a body doing a specific thing, he does the same thing with the body every time, and it'll fit one club, and the other poor 13 clubs have to take a back seat. Whereas if I swing my club the right way, the plane on which I've set it is taken care of by the swing, because every object which is swinging stays on the same plane through its own centrifugal force and returns to the original point of impact all by itself. Ladies and gentlemen, it was an honor to be here with you. As you see, I don't enjoy talking. I think that these things are just absolutely fantastic, the sharing of ideas, and it doesn't matter whether you agree with me or whether you don't. I think that the exposure to different ideas is refreshing, and the fact that you listen, I appreciate. Thank you very much.